save all of His precious blood.
Hey, Coondog, this one is super hot in this wedge over here.
name is Shaylin Cook, and I am the Connections Director right here at Central. I'm so glad that you're worshiping with us this weekend. Proverbs 27:17 says, as iron sharpens iron, so a friend sharpens a friend. This verse is referring to the sharpening that comes from being around like-minded people who encourage and challenge each other. My prayer for you is to step into community and be united with the body of Christ. Take action today by filling out a Connect card. You can submit a Connect card online or bring it to the Blue Room after service, and I would love to connect with you. Getting involved is one of the best ways to surround yourself with like-minded people who want to encourage and challenge you. Two great ways to get involved are by serving or joining a group. Believe me, I know that taking that first step can be a little scary and uncomfortable, but I promise you that it is worth it, and I'm here to help you and encourage you as you navigate how you want to get involved. Reach out to me at any time, shaylin@centralnow.com, or stop by the Blue Room after service. You're not meant to go through life alone. Now is the time to be surrounded by a community that walks with you and pushes you to Christ.
On a beautiful Sunday morning. August is halfway over. Man, did you ever know of a year that's going by any faster than this year's gone by? I mean, there's just basically 5.5 months left of the year. But there's no better place to be on Sunday morning at 8 o'clock than being in Mount Vernon, Illinois, at Central Christian Church, praising God and fellowshipping with fellow believers. That's what we're made to be here and be social people and celebrate what Jesus Christ has done for us in restoring our relationship with our Heavenly Father. I spent a week at the Grand Canyon didn't jump off the ledge, but it was attempting a few times, and I mean, because I don't like heights. And I thought, you know, God's hand and his finger created that so that we could experience God's beauty and wisdom. And I thought to myself, if I were in charge of creation, everything would probably be painted blue, since that's my favorite color. And that's why we think of God in all of his wisdom, and we just can't even understand the colors that he's dealing with. It's just absolutely amazing. And on the way over from Fairfield this morning, I was listening to a radio on Christian music, and it said that Jesus is building a house for us, or a place to live, by his own hands. And when you see the things that's around the world, that's absolutely breathtaking. Just imagine how much better that's going to be than anything we can ever imagine. The Sunday school lesson is on a new city today that I'm leading downstairs, and it talks about how beautiful heaven will be, but it's beyond our comprehension. If you would stand up and sing with us, "In my heart there rings a melody." So sing, because you're going to be singing a lot in heaven. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. 'Tis a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. I love the Christ who died on Calvary, for he washed my sins away. He put within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to stay. In my heart there rings a melody. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. 'Twill be my endless theme in glory. With the angels I will sing. 'Twill be a song with glorious harmony. When the chords of amazing is that we can be hidden by God from all the cares that go on in the world. And there are a lot of cares. Man, God loves us that much that he hides our soul. Wow. If you would, two verses of "He Hideth My Soul." A wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Lord. A wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, that shadows a dry thirst. A wonderful Savior is Jesus.
Jesus, my Lord, he taketh my burden away. He holdeth me up, and I shall not be moved. He giveth me strength as my day. He hideth my soul.
Good morning, everyone. You may have a seat. I am excited to share with you information about groups here at Central Christian Church, give you a quick update because we've been getting lots of questions about what's going on with our fall session of groups. And our fall session of groups is scheduled to kick off on September the 18th. Registration is now open, though, so if you wanted to sign up today, you could do that. Our groups will meet once a week on Sunday nights from 6 to 7:30. Child care is available, and you have three different study options that you can choose from. So really good options for you there. And when you choose to sign up for groups for this fall, I want you to know that you are just simply making a short-term commitment, like 8 to 10 weeks, depending on which study you sign up for. You are not, hear me when I say this, you are not committing to being part of a group that lasts forever, ever till Jesus returns. So I hope everyone here gives serious consideration to taking part in a group. If you've never been part of like our fall or winter groups, I don't know, maybe you're new to Central, or maybe you've just never chosen to be part of that. I can say with complete confidence that should you sign up and take part in it, when it's all over with, you're going to walk away from that and say, boy, I am sure glad that I chose to take part in groups here at Central. And here's why, you know, here's why we give so much attention to this, why it is so important. Now, in addition to the impact that it has on us as individuals, taking part in groups, the impact that it has on us as individuals, there's also kind of the perspective from the entire church as well, because as the people of Central, as they're growing in their faith, as they're connecting with others, as they're building unity with other people, and that all happens as part of groups, and when it does, it just does amazing things. We can do so many great things for God's kingdom. And so I hope that every one of us just prayerfully considers being part of our groups this fall, that you'll sign up for that. You can go to centralnow.com/groups to get more information about the different studies that are available and to sign up. Or I will be in the atrium to answer any questions that you might have after services today. So please, sign up for groups. Trev has got some amazing things going on, fun stuff going on in our men's group. Let's watch this video.
Hey, I'm Josh, big time Dolphins fan. A couple years ago, I'd never played fantasy football, but now it's one of the things I look forward to every single year. There's nothing like crushing the hopes and dreams of your buddy when your player catches a 50-yard touchdown pass.
Hey, my name's Eric, big Miami Dolphins fan, way bigger than Josh. This is the type of thing you're going to want to be a part of. There's a reason over 60 million people play fantasy football every year. It's an easy and fun way to get to know people better. Imagine a ton of men watching football, eating food together at church during the fall. Give it a try, and I'll take your team to the woodshed and show you the ropes.
Hey, I'm Kyle. Hey, I've never played before, but if there was a fantasy league for superheroes, I'd dominate that one. I don't know what the difference is between a slant route and a post route, but I can pick players and watch the scores with my opponents, and I'm just looking forward to going out, hanging out with some friends, and get to eat some food. That's the big thing, free food.
Hey, I'm Dan, lifelong Chicago Bears fan. Fantasy football is old hat to me. I've been playing this since you track scores in the newspaper. It's easy to follow and a great way to stay connected to others. You should definitely give it a shot here at Central.
Hey, I'm Trevor, and this is going to be really great. Sign up and save the date, Tuesday, August 30th, for the night you draft your team right here at the church. You can register on Central's website, the app, or the Central Men's Facebook group. Find me or email me with questions, and good luck.
You have to sign up.
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 John's going to be giving a lesson on an innocent mind. And I thought with the title of that, when did I lose my innocence as a child? And I couldn't help but thinking Adam and Eve had two choices. They could either eat of the tree of life or they could eat of the tree of good and evil, the knowledge of good and evil. And they chose the knowledge of good and evil. And haven't we been paying a price for that for centuries? Are you any better off for knowing the difference between good and evil? My twin brother and I went to the University of Illinois, and we had a lot of fun up there. Being twins, we could fool a lot of people. And a friend of mine said one time, you know, that was quite a bit older than I, she said, "What did the University of Illinois teach you in the fraternities and sororities?" And I said, "Well, I don't know. I thought it quite a bit." And she said, "Well, they taught me shoddy values." And I thought, that's what the world has to offer us, shoddy values, when it's compared with what God has to offer us through Jesus Christ and what's written in the Bible. So we need to be in the Word daily and praying daily and keeping a hold of the righteous values and the better way that God has for us. We have two choices, the bad way or the worse way or a better way. No one has cared for us like Jesus, and he will care for us through our life and take us on to heaven. So if you would sing with me, most of you might not even know "No One Ever Cared for Me Like Jesus," because it's normally not a congregational hymn, but one that someone sings as special. But if you would join in, it's a beautiful, relaxing hymn, "No One Ever Cared for Me Like Jesus."
I would like to tell you what I think of Jesus. Since I found in him a friend so strong and true, I would tell you how he changed my life completely. He did something
best way to get through life is to stay as close to the cross as possible, to be near as to Jesus Christ as you can possibly be. Never get outside of the shadow of the cross. All kinds of mischief and trouble will happen the further you get away from the cross. The closer you get, the more strength you have from the Holy Spirit. If you would, near to the heart of God.
There is a place of quiet rest near to the heart of God, a place where sin cannot molest, near to the heart of God. Oh, Jesus, blessed Redeemer, near to the heart of God. Hold us to wait before thee, near to the heart of God. There is a place of comfort sweet, near to the heart of God, a place where we our Savior meet, near to the heart of God. Oh, Jesus, blessed Redeemer, sent from the heart of God, hold us who wait before thee, near to the heart of God.
We are so thankful for the ways that you partner with us to be the hands and feet of Jesus through your time, your prayers, and your resources. And one of the ways that you can partner with us is through the giving of your tithes and offerings. There are several ways that you can do that, and they are listed for you on the screens. We are so thankful for your commitment to generous giving. As we head into our time of communion, if you didn't grab one of those double-stacked cups, you can find those located in the tunnel. Worship music is a big part of my life. It is often a way that I can express the things in my heart that I couldn't articulate on my own. It shifts my focus off of what's happening horizontally, and it forces me to look vertically. It connects my heart with God's and His with mine. And I have a playlist miles long, but recently I've been coming back to the simplicity of these lyrics. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. There is a call in those lyrics to remember who this is all about and who it is for. Worship gives us an opportunity to remember our first love. And when we do that, we remember what Christ did on the cross for us. 1 Corinthians 11:26 tells us that, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Communion was instituted by Jesus. He commanded its observance, and he asked that it be done in remembrance and celebration of his sacrifice and love. The symbolism of his bread as the broken body and the cup as his shed blood are a call to us as believers to remember that he voluntarily offered his life on the cross. And in the greatest act of love, Jesus's body was broken for you. His blood was shed for you. He willingly gave up his life on the cross, and he was thinking of you. Why? Because he is madly in love with you. To him, the pain of you, his creation, being far from him, was greater than the pain of the crucifixion. He took that pain, the weight, the shame, and the heaviness of every single sin we ever have or will ever commit, and He allowed it to crush Him so that you and I can experience freedom. There is no plan B with the love of God. You are the one that He wants. You are the one that He chases down. And it is you that He is calling into relationship with Him, back to the heart of worship. So I'm gonna pray, and then would you just take a few minutes and connect your heart with your Savior and King, and remember and thank Him. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank You for the sacrificial death of Jesus on the cross. We thank You, God, that He took our place. We thank You that You pursue us, that You never leave us or forsake us, and that You are calling us back to the heart of worship and back into a relationship with You. We thank You and we praise You and we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Taking your communion, Kate and I are going to do what technically is be called a special, but I would rather it be more of another hymn that we all sing together. It's super familiar. I grew up in a little church near here. My wife would say I'm still growing up, but Lebanon Baptist Church was my first church that I grew up in. Then I went to Logan Street, and my family is a very musical family. So at Lebanon, my grandpa was the music leader there. And then my parents and uncles were in a Christian group called Shades of Calvary. Shout out to the Shades of Calvary. But John's going to be talking about singing praises to God. And growing up in a musical family, that's kind of where our root was. That was our go-to, you know, around the table, we would sing together. Around the house, we would sing together. We were cleaning, we would sing harmonies with a vacuum cleaner. So there was always music in our life. And, you know, at the down times, when you're hurting, when you're lost, there's always a song that you can go to pick you up. Or when you're happy, excited, there's always a song you can go to share that praise with. So we're going to sing a song together that's super familiar, and one that Papa, my grandpa, used to sing all the time at Lebanon, Come Thou Fount. And Kate's going to sing and play with me, so I encourage all of you to sing along with us.
Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for song of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious song sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon Him, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I am, by thy great help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus, help me when a stranger wandering from the fold of God, me to rescue me from danger, interposed His precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my walk. Yeah.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Wow, that was a really good morning. Thanks. I appreciate that. Hey, it's good to see you all here in the room this morning for this 8 a.m. service. If you are new or relatively new to Central Christian Church, if this is your first time here, or maybe you've been coming for a little while and you just have never stopped by the Blue Room, do me a favor. There is a place straight out of this center tunnel, looks just like that, across the atrium. It's called the Blue Room. I'd love to meet you there after this service. Shake your hand. We also have a gift for you if this is your first time, or you've just been coming for a little while and have never stopped by the Blue Room. If you're joining us online today, wherever you are, we want to say hello to you. I know there are people in all kinds of different places right now watching online. So welcome to you. Welcome to this service from wherever you are. We would love to see you back in this room sometime real soon. But until that day comes, everybody in the room, let's welcome all those joining us online this morning. You know, one other thing before I dive into the sermon this morning, I just wanted to say thank you to you, like the church family, for your faithful giving and support of this ministry, because my goodness, was it on display yesterday at the backpack block party. It was such a cool thing. I mean, the need is real, and it was just love in action at the park right here in Mount Vernon. And like, 3 or 4 weeks ago, we told you we had 75 backpacks to hand out. And then yesterday, because of the way that you guys helped and brought in and then even provided for some extra above so that we could hand out Bibles yesterday, that was a really cool part of that deal. And we handed out 1,253 backpacks yesterday. So praise God for that. Thank you. So I got to tell you, I think God sings. I think that God sings. I have three girls, as you know, and we are in this series called Insights from an Innocent Mind, where we are learning from the mindset of children. And so I have these three girls, Lyric, Ella, and Haven, 11, 10, and 1. And I told you last week, I feel like I have learned more in my 11 years of being a dad than I did in the 30 years that I lived before that. Seeing life through a child's eyes gives us a whole different kind of perspective. We learn love from the other side of the equation. Years ago, Lyric, our oldest daughter, who's now 11, she was probably 2. We'll say she was 2 years old. She was falling asleep for the night, and she was actually laying next to me in my bed, sleeping next to me. Don't judge me, people. She was laying next to us in bed, and she fell asleep, and she hadn't been asleep for just a few minutes, and she pops up, eyes wide open, and says, "Daddy, Daddy, God sings. God sings like you. God sings, Daddy." And I was like, okay, like, I mean, how do you know, Lyric? I mean, where's this coming from? She says, "I heard him. I heard God sing. God sings, Daddy." And she was so convinced that she had heard God sing in that moment. I think a lot of us would have woken up and said, oh man, I just had this weird dream. But as a child, the innocence of her mind, she wakes up and she says, I heard God sing. And I really believe that the innocence of a child allows them access to an acceptance of things that sometimes we just rule ourselves out of. Acceptance that we don't have as adults. Because the older we get, the more complicated things get for us. Our minds get more complicated. Our worlds become more complicated. As adults, we become more self-reliant and self-aware and insecure at the same time. We have seen a lot of things. We've seen hurt and let down. We have let people down and we've been let down. We've disappointed people and people have disappointed us. We have walked through a lot of things in life, and so we end up getting jaded. Our hearts get a little bit cold. Our guard goes up. Walls go up, and there ends up being spiritual things that we miss out on. But I believe that the inexperience of a child allows like a freshness to life or a purity of their mind that gives them this unquestioning acceptance of things that we just don't accept sometimes as adults. So no doubt we can and should be learning from children. I think God has so much to teach us from innocent minds of children. So we're going to talk about singing a little bit today, because as we grow, as we get older, as people, men especially, I feel like we sing less, particularly in church, but we sing less. But if you go to like Fantastic Nights or a children's concert, or maybe you go hang out in Kid Depot for a weekend, kids are just wailing it out, whether they can sing or not. They're just letting it rip and singing it out. But parents, not so much. We'll stand there kind of with our arms crossed. We'll take it in. We'll give a nice little nod here and there. But we're not really going to sing, you know? Why? Why is that? Like, for real, I'm soliciting input here. Why don't we sing as much as maybe we used to, or as much as children sing? Just yell something out. Ron, why don't we sing as much? We're embarrassed about our voice. Yeah. Who else? Why else?
Confidence.
Confidence. Yeah, I think that's a big one. Give me one more. Why else don't we sing?
Other distractions.
Yeah. Those are all real good ones. But here's the thing. Listen to this. Like so many other things in life or in our spiritual walk, just because it is uncomfortable doesn't mean that it is unnecessary. Singing is a spiritual discipline that we are better for embracing. You say, like, I don't like music at all. That's not my thing. It's not really your call. You say, like, well, these songs that we're singing are not my style song. They don't have to be. You say, I'm a shy person or I'm not a good singer. It doesn't matter. Scripture tells us so many times to sing to the Lord. Seriously, leave this place and Google singing in the Bible, and you will find a list so long of the Bible referencing singing. God wants us to use the breath in our lungs to return it to the one who gave it to us in the first place as praise in the way that he asks us to do that. So we're going to look at five quick reasons for us to sing, okay? So if you're writing stuff down, you could write this down. The first one is we sing to obey. We sing to obey. If we believe the Bible, and we do, we believe that the Bible is God's holy word. It has no errors in it. This is our written instruction from God for walking through life. And like I said, in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, all throughout the Bible, it talks about us singing. And like everything else, we cannot just pick and choose the parts of instruction in the Scripture that we want to live by. Singing is not the only thing that the Bible tells us to do, but it is certainly included in what the Bible tells us to do. Listen to this. This is in Ephesians chapter 5. So be careful how you live. Don't live like fools, but like those who are wise. Make the most of every opportunity in these evil days. Don't act thoughtlessly, but understand what the Lord wants you to do. And here it is. Don't be drunk with wine, because that will ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Singing, right here, is an important part of our worship. And to not sing is to not fully obey. And there are other benefits to singing as well. So if you're writing stuff down, this is number two. We sing to fight. We sing to fight. Sometimes I think that we think the worship portion or the music portion is just kind of like to set the mood for the service. And really it's more to prepare our heart and to do actually this, because we forget that singing in worship is an actual weapon in an actual war that is going on all around us. That is the one thing that sets worship music apart from every other kind of music on the planet. I mean, singing is one thing, and you can sing just any old song, but at the end, it's just going to be another song. But when you sing songs of praise, it is a weapon. And the Bible is clear that there is this constant, ongoing battle around us. Ephesians 6:12 says, "For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places." Part of us engaging in this battle is, in fact, singing. Now, to be clear, it's not just the singing. It's much deeper than that. Matthew 15, Jesus said this. He said that there's going to be people who honor me with their lips, but their hearts are still far from me. You can sing, but it's the heart that makes the difference. It's not just the song, it's what you're singing. It is the heart of what you're singing. It is ultimately who you're singing to that brings the power to the fight. 2 Corinthians says, "The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds." Last week, one of our volunteers didn't even know that we were talking about this today. And one of our volunteers brought in this little note that his grandson had drawn a couple of days earlier, talking about exactly this. And his grandson had drawn this: musical weapons. We've got a flute sword. We've got a guitar sword. A bow harp. I mean, these are some serious weapons. And I think it kind of seems silly to us a little bit, right? But maybe not. Because in 1 Samuel, we read about King Saul, who is being tormented by evil spirits. And when that happens, they call on a godly man, David, to come and play his bow. And that eases this spiritual tension. When we lift a song for the purpose of praise, the Bible says that we are fighting in the spiritual realm. And it's not just in church. I mean, this is a great place to start, a great place to participate in that, but it's not just here. It's when you're singing in the car, or when you're standing around doing laundry. Maybe when you're putting your kids to bed at night and you kneel down next to the bed and you're just singing something over them. That is why Kevin and Kent and Eric and all of our worship leaders analyze the songs that we sing and look at the words that we are asking you to sing, because it's important what we're singing. That's why there's so much scripture in our songs. That's why the name of Jesus is so prevalent in the songs that we sing, because whether it is inside of church or outside of this building, singing like that carries a different kind of power, because it's power that comes from the name of Jesus. And the Bible says there is no power in heaven or hell that can stand against him. He has already ultimately won the victory. And so we sing with him in a place of, from a place of victory. And that is reason to celebrate, which brings us to number three. We sing for joy to the world. We sing for joy. Sometimes it's just a normal thing. In every country, in every culture, there is some form of celebrating through song. Our spirits are lifted, our minds are encouraged, feet start tapping and our hands start clapping, and we accept the song as part of the celebration. We do it at birthday parties, right? We sing happy birthday. It's just part of the celebration. I'm a St. Louis Cardinals fan, but one thing that I appreciate about the Chicago Cubs culture is that song that they sing when they win. You know, they throw the W up and then they sing that, "Go Cubs, go, go." You guys know that song? They did not sing it when they played the Cardinals last week at all, but that's our, I still appreciate that about their culture. It is true that we celebrate through song in our physical life. It should be just as true or more in our spiritual life, because God is faithful. He always has been. He always will be. He provides for his children. He protects his children. He is worthy of being celebrated through song. That is why the Bible says, "My lips will shout for joy when I sing praise to you. I, whom you have delivered." All of us have been delivered. If we call in the name of Jesus as Savior and Lord, we have been the recipients of his deliverance, his mercy, his love. And eternally speaking, God made a way for us to be delivered from the pit of hell. And that is certainly something to sing about. Number four, we sing for strength. We sing for strength. Now, I'm going to talk specifically to the men in the room for just a second. I think, guys, we think sometimes that singing is a sign of weakness. Like, real men don't cry and real men don't sing. There's a lot of singing in my life, so I take personal offense to that, because also if you're looking for a demonstration of manliness, no, I'm just kidding. But I expected some sort of applause there or a cheer, you know. Singing might seem unnatural to you, but there is something supernatural about it that makes it super important in our spiritual walk. But it's even less about the strength we receive than it is about the strength that we seek, because these battles are way beyond us. Psalm 22:3 says, "You are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel." Or another version of Scripture says it this way: God inhabits the praises of his people. So when his people are bringing praise or singing praise, it brings a different kind of power. It brings God to the situation, and there is no greater strength than his. I think about some guys in the Bible, Paul and Silas. They were traveling and doing good, godly work, and they end up beaten and locked up in prison. And I think their natural response could very well have been to yell or to fight it, to protest, maybe just to wallow in despair, get depressed, feel defeated, and just kind of sit there. But instead, we read this in Acts chapter 16. Around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. So they're locked up and they're singing hymns to God. And look what happens. All the other prisoners were listening, and suddenly there was a massive earthquake, and the prison was shaken to its foundations. All the doors immediately flew open, and the chains of every prisoner fell off. Despite their circumstance, these men chose to sing. They chose to praise. And as a result, a strength greater than any prison or chain or shackle or hardship shows up and shakes the foundation of the prison. And did you catch that? It didn't just benefit the guys that were singing. Every other prisoner was set free as well. God might have plans to use your obedience in singing to help free somebody else. Life isn't easy, and there will be times that we walk through things that we just don't have the strength on our own to get through. But the Bible says in our weakness, his strength is made perfect. In our weakness, we have the option to sit and sulk in it, or we can sing through it. And you know, there's so many examples, like not just in the Bible, not just from years ago, but like ongoing examples right now, like actual people living this very concept out. I think about my friend Blake Wheeler, who is fighting a super rare disease, but almost every weekend he's part of leading worship at Lebanon Baptist Church. I think of Rick and Sarah Hayes, who have just walked through some horrible stuff with their son being hospitalized for a long time and then ending up losing his life here on earth. But today, this very morning, Rick and Sarah are still pastoring at Orchardville Church. They are still praising even today. I think about people in our own church family who are walking through sickness, diagnosis, hardship, treatments that are just stripping them of dignity, but yet every weekend they show up in this place and they sing praise even through it. I think about Mark and Carol Rudofsky, who sit right here in this second row almost every single weekend. Their son was killed years ago in a car or in an accident, and they still show up every single weekend. They sit here and they lift their hands and they sing praise. All of these people and so many others have chosen to still sing because they have chosen to believe in the ultimate goodness of the God that we are singing to. And they understand that God honoring singing brings God only strength to the circumstance. But above all, even if there was nothing in it for us, even if there was no joy or strength or benefit to us, the reason that we sing to glorify God. That is what true worship, that is what true singing praise is all about. Jesus was coming into town, and we find this in Luke chapter 19. When he reached the place where the road started down the Mount of Olives, all of his followers began to shout and sing as they walked along, praising God for all the wonderful miracles they had seen. Blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in highest heaven. But some of the Pharisees among the crowd said, "Teacher, rebuke your followers for saying things like that." And look what Jesus said back. He replied, "If they kept quiet, the stones along the road would burst into cheers." It is more than a recommendation to you to sing. Singing is a requirement for Christ followers, because if we don't do it, the rest of creation is going to step into place and do it for us. Inanimate objects like rocks will shout out the praise of their maker. And so God is calling us not to have everything all together all the time, but even in the low points, to choose to believe and choose to praise through song, to lift our eyes and to lift our voice. on the mountaintops, when we are celebrating. He's calling us to use a song in that and to sing for joy with grateful hearts in the car, in the yard, at home, at church. I believe that it is God's will for us, his children, to be known as a singing people. Because it is not about us, it is all about glorifying the God who gave us the opportunity and ability to be able to make a sound for his glory. So, you remember last week we ended our service with the sweet prayer of a child, and I hope that you have been thinking less of yourself. Maybe you've been not thinking of yourself as highly as you once did. Maybe you've been a little more humble this week. I also hope that you've been praying some simple prayers, but we're also going to put this into practice right now. All right, it might be a little awkward, might be a little uncomfortable, but that's okay. It's not for you. It's not about, actually, comfort and dignity are not actually on the list of things that God is calling us to, but singing from a humble heart with a childlike kind of faith and surrender is. So let's demonstrate that. Why don't you guys stand up? All right, we're gonna sing this song. But there is your note, la 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 la, and it doesn't matter where you land on it, you just make a noise. All right, so men, let's lead the way on this. We're going to go guys first, and then ladies, I'll let you know when to jump in. I see the uncomfort in your eyes right now. That's all right. All right, here we go. You ready? Oh, Lord my God, when I am, consider the world's thy hand. All right, ladies, let them hear it. I see, I hear thy power, the universe. All right, now everybody then sings my, how great thou. How great then sings my Savior. How great. All right, you sound good. Now, ladies, this time you're going to lead it out. You got the first half of the verse. And when I think that God is done, that God is sparing. Oh, hold up. We got different words. All right, so we're going to go. And when I think that God is son not sparing. All right, here we go. Ready? Two, three. And when I think that God sent him to, I scarce can take it. All right, men, let it rip. Come on. That on the cross my burden. Come on. He bled and died to take away my. Come on, then sings my soul. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. Yeah. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. All right, now men, when Christ shall come. Ready? Here we go. One, two. Oh, when Christ shall come, oh, with shouts of, and take me home, what joy. Then I shall bow, ladies. Then I shall, come on, and everybody, and there proclaim my God, how great. Then sings my soul, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou, how great thou art. Then sings my Savior God, How great thou art. You sing it again. How great thou art. How great. One more time. How great. How great. How great thou art. You sound really good. Now listen to this. Zephaniah 3:17. For the Lord your God is living among you. He's a mighty Savior. He will take delight in you with gladness. With his love, he will calm all of your fears. Here it is. He will rejoice over you with joyful songs. So I know God sings. And we should too. So sing through you as you go through your week. Sing to honor him and bring your singing voice with you when you come back here next weekend. God bless you guys. Have a fantastic week. Huh?